So, here's an interesting thing I saw the other day. This social media post went somewhat viral in the area of Rainbow City, Alabama, being shared over 28,000 times, and making some serious claims and charges toward the city's police department, positing that the police tased and beat, quote, half to death, as well as viciously pushing this man off a bridge for no apparent reason. Seems to me to be a clear-cut case of horrific police brutality, am I right? For if Black Lives Matter has taught us anything, of course, there is a proclivity for the police to racially profile people of color, to assault and victimize them, usually, if not always, for no reason beyond the color of their skin. Absolutely abhorrent and sickening, is it not? Of course, this case is one of those instances. This poor innocent man is now lying in a hospital after having been airlifted out of Gadsden. Well, bit of interesting coincidence there, isn't it? No step. But he is lying in a hospital bed with broken teeth and a neck brace after being thrown off a 19-foot bridge because the police, you know what? They just hate black people. The police in the United States, regardless of their own race, I suppose, hate black people almost as much as does Donald Trump, who, as we all know thanks to the Steele dossier, hates them so much that he has to excuse himself from the delicate sensibilities of his pissing ladies of the evening to go into a bathroom and shout about it, to literally shout, "I hate black people." Again, thank you Steele dossier for that tidbit of information. Anyway, these graphic and troubling images illustrate the depths of the depravity and inhumane behavior of the police, who mercilessly beat this poor, innocent man. As the Facebook post, which began to gain a semblance of attention across social media, explains, the police, those power-obsessed animals, must certainly and clearly pay for this cruelty. This is abhorrent. This is inexcusable. This is police brutality, and this right here, my friends, is why Black Lives Matter is necessary. Except, sorry, can't hold up the narrative too long. Here's what actually happened. As can be fully corroborated by the body camera footage released by the Rainbow City Police Department within a few hours of this Facebook post gaining some internet notoriety.
We know who you are, man. Turn around, put your phone on the... Hey! Come on. Get on the ground! Oh, shit. Get on the ground! Let me see your hands!
The man in question, the one who, according to his baby mama, who hilariously, I guess, has the wherewithal, I suppose, to refer to him as, quote, my kid's dad. Jesus fucking Christ, my wife's son isn't a meme at all, is it? Who she claims didn't do nothing, did, in fact, do at least a few nothings, as he was pulled over with another driver. He gave a false name and identity to the police, and upon further investigation was found to have had multiple outstanding felony warrants for probation revocation, dangerous drugs, as well as misdemeanor traffic violations. Let me explain and give you a quick rundown of the scenario, okay, friends? So the woman who was driving the car was pulled over for some reason, admittedly a reason for which I am not sure, as it has not yet been made salient or public by the Rainbow City Police Department. But nonetheless, the driver was pulled over and the police asked for the identity of the man in the passenger seat. Before I move forward, I do want to note that this is not really or necessarily standard procedure, and the U.S. Court of Appeals in the case of Stufflebeam v. Harris has upheld that the passenger is under no obligation to provide identification during a routine traffic stop. Only the driver is required to present proof of identity in addition to license, registration, and proof of insurance. I will mention, as I have mentioned before, and as I may go into some more detail into explication, that there is a preponderance of individuals who possess the dark triad personality trait of psychopathy to go into police work. This is why I have a tendency to distrust the police in general on aggregate. Again, I am a social scientist, I always speak in averages, or at least most of the time. Sorry about that, I know that can be a little bit confusing. It doesn't mean that I dislike any individual police officer, nor do I dislike any individual person, unless you have given me reason to dislike you. I had to just look at things, however, on aggregate, and we do find a statistical proclivity and preponderance of people who are interested or go into police work to have the personality trait of psychopathy. And despite all of my conservative tendencies, You, dear viewer, may be surprised to note that I am in fact an adamant proponent of cop watch, or any form of citizen action to ensure the police themselves are policed by the citizens. This is not because I don't value the work of our boys in blue to protect average citizens, but rather because, yes, I am aware of the proclivity that the police or people who go into police have towards psychopathy. And you know what? Yeah. The research also does in fact indicate that the police, regardless of their own race, do tend to hold heuristic biases against people of color. But do you know why that is? Well, it's because, real talk, black people commit more crime than whites in this country proportionally. Despite representing about 12 to 13% of the total United States population, black people commit generally about 28% of overall crime, according to the FBI arrest statistics circa 2014. These statistics are particularly damning when assessing individual types of crime. For example, African Americans commit 51% of homicides and 55% of robberies. Again, that is 51% and 55% respectively. These are numbers that come out of the understanding that black people, again, only comprise about 12 to 13% of the population. As such, it is no surprise from a cognitive heuristic standpoint that the police tend to be more likely to suspect and hold cognitive biases against African Americans. They are simply operating on experience and numerical data that consistently indicate, for example, any black person at random stopped in traffic is approximately 5 times more likely to have committed a homicide than a white person, and over 100 times more likely to have committed a homicide than an Asian person randomly stopped in traffic. Now again, these are all averages. We have to understand this, and friends, I'm gonna have to make a video on averages and explaining how the fuck that shit works, because I'm starting to think no one understands that. Yes, but on average, 5 times more likely than a white person and 100 times more likely than an Asian person. Those are just the statistics. And don't get me wrong, this doesn't work unidirectionally. This isn't some conspiracy theory bullshit. I always back up everything I say with statistics. But also, typically speaking, black people are, in addition to being more likely to commit crime, also far, far more likely to be the victims of violent crime than whites and Asians or any other racial demographic in the United States. My point is, Black Lives Matter, the terrorist organization that they are, and don't be confused, they are a terrorist organization, are not incorrect when they assume that the police tend to be overly cautious at best and overly aggressive at worst towards black people. However, the statistics need to be examined to help understand and explain why such a trend exists. And it exists because police officers, through their daily work, as we can see confirmed through the statistical data I have mentioned above, are simply more likely to handle black criminals in a larger proportion than criminals of any other race, just in terms of proportion. I'm not making any kind of claim to say that there's some sort of racial determinant here. These are just the statistics. I know statistics hurt people's feelings, apparently, but them's the breaks. Now, one final time, there are far fewer black people in the United States than white people, and yet, for some crimes, specifically such as homicide and robbery, black people are between 4 to 5 times more likely to perpetuate said crimes than white people. This is basic odds ratio shit, my dudes. And if your job requires you placing yourself in a potentially life-threatening situation day in and day out, well, no fucking shit, you gotta crunch them numbers. Ugh, I've already gotten so far off track I can't remember what the fuck I was talking about in the first place. Oh yes, the bridge jumper who didn't do nothing. So with our little statistics and social science lesson for the day over with, let's get back to the case at hand. Upon being asked about his identity, the man stated he, quote, had never obtained an Alabama driver's license and did not know his social security number. Again, as I stated earlier, there is legal precedent in the United States that indicates a passenger is under no legal obligation to provide his or her identification to a police officer during a traffic stop. As I've said, this does seem a bit suspect to me, and the video footage conveniently begins shortly after the police learn of the suspect's true identity and his outstanding warrants. Now, let's real talk here. This is a guy who was involved in some unquestionably skeevy shit, and the police probably made the right call by attempting to identify him. However, one last time, this is not standard procedure, and had this man simply said that he refused to provide the police with his identification because he was in his rights to do so, and he was within his rights, he may have gotten away with this. He may not have had to run away and leap off a bridge, as I believe he thought was his only option. Instead, however, he lied to them. Here's a pro tip: don't fucking lie to the police. I'm not really sure what is worse in terms of antagonizing the cops, either to just deny them and say, am I being detained, or to outright lie. I think outright lying, though, is a little bit worse. And again, I don't want to turn this into some libertarian am I being detained bullshit, but the point is that although the cops weren't technically legally right to require him to provide identification, they did actually locate a wanted felon in the process. They were in the wrong to request and require his identification, but he was a wanted felon. You, my friend, you can be the judge of the legal and moral quandary faced here and what the outcome truly is, but what follows was pretty straightforward. Upon being approached by an officer, as you can see here in the video footage, with evidence of the man's true identity and outstanding warrants, he immediately Usain Bolts the fuck out, leaping over the road's median like a fucking Olympic athlete, and gracefully over the side of this bridge, where he fell and smashed his teeth and neck as the cops, in something of a beautiful moment of absurdity, shouted at him to remain on the ground. Yeah, friendos, I don't think he's getting up anytime real soon. Although he did certainly try, as the video footage indicates. At which point, yes, the cops did tase him. Now, I must ask, did you really need to tase a man who just fell 19 feet and probably cracked half his ribcage? Probably not, but be aware, he did not stop resisting, even after his 19-foot folly. Of course, this footage, although edited to not reveal the conversations that took place before the leap of fugitive faith, do not represent nor reflect the account of baby mama, Samantha Weasley. Samantha Weasley. Seriously? What the fuck this bint look like? Ah, of course, dyed hair. Choker, obnoxious shirt about girl power. Well, imagine my shock that this is the baby mama wanting to make these absurd and baseless claims of police brutality on Facebook space. Anyway, coal-burning thought aside, let's talk about the implications of this particular situation. Obviously, Samantha Weasley thought she was going to get some big government money out of this by playing off the BLM narrative that the cops are always out to maim and injure black people. Again, a topic that I have explained in detail, and while I am most strongly in opposition to police violence against the citizenry, well, there is some bias in police behavior that is logical given the statistical probability of criminality associated more highly with African Americans in this country. Again, I find police violence abhorrent and am skeptical, TM, toward the police at large because of their psychological personality type propensity for psychopathy. Damn, that's a lot of alliteration. Anywho, the point is that had it not been for this body cam, I would imagine this post would have received far more than 28,000 views and likes and shares. It would have gotten a hell of a lot more media attention than it did, given the swift response of the Rainbow City Police in releasing the actual footage, which clearly shows our baby daddy jumping off the bridge by his own volition and not being pushed off it by the big, mean, evil police, as his baby mama insisted. I want to bring this entire situation up because I'm going to make a prediction here, friends, and I want you all to come back to this video in a couple of months or years to determine whether I'm right or wrong to either berate or celebrate my prophetic or not-so-prophetic wisdom or antithesis thereof. Remember when Black Lives Matter called for the police in the United States to wear body cameras? I sure do. It was a major issue. Many activists called for the use of body cameras, and in fact, it was one issue that I was wholly in support of. There are very few things about BLM that I support, but body cameras were one of the things that, yes, I triumphed, because further responsibility and accountability for the police is something that is in fact desperately needed. It is the same reason that dash cams became essentially ubiquitous in Russia to fight against police corruption, and generally hilarious drunk driving, but you know, it's a Slavic country, you're always going to get that. Of course, this is not a perfect solution, given that, for example, an Indiana Supreme Court upheld that an officer's judgment was more accurate than his dash cam footage when it came to pulling over a driver who, in according to the officer's testimony, and not the visual and video evidence, was veering over the fog line. But body cam and dash cam footage are important to help reduce police corruption, and is one of the few things I did truly agree with BLM on, at least in BLM's sort of infancy, before it became overwhelmingly obvious that they were being funded by George Soros and others. As such, we have seen a surge in the commonality of body cameras for the police in the years since Ferguson, seemingly in reaction to BLM's petitions for such. I am completely and 100% behind the use of body cameras for police officers for the very reasons have been recently made evident in the case of Justine Ruschek, an Australian citizen and resident of Minneapolis who was shot at point-blank range after calling the police to report two suspected incidences of sexual assault by, in fact, the city's first Somali-American officer who claims that he heard a loud noise and was startled, firing his weapon. The police are already claiming this in Minneapolis, and I guarantee this will get worse, that the officers just aren't used to turning on their body cameras. Well, do they at least train you in trigger discipline, motherfucker? This case is unacceptable on every level. Justine was left with a fatal wound to the abdomen just a month before her wedding for calling 911 to try and help another. The responsible officer, Mohammed Noor, has, as of this recording, not yet made a personal statement while speaking through his lawyer to relay his condolences and insists that he believes police work to be his calling. And that right there, friends, yup, that is why we need body cameras. It's why I support body cameras and dash cam. Because of abuse cases such as that at Justine, or any person who was shot or injured by the police who, by the words of the Minneapolis police chief herself, Janae Hartu, did not need to die. Because of fucking course she didn't. She was doing her due diligence as a good person. And now she's dead. And despite how desperately the city will, just watch this, try to weasel its way out of this already, claiming, as I said, that the officers, you know, hey, we're just not accustomed to remembering to turn on our recording equipment. This appears to me to be, without question, even at this early juncture, to be a massive and flat-out repulsive abuse of deadly force on the part of the police. But here is my prediction, given this little case study with I Believe I Can Fly here. Soon, very soon in fact, my friends, I think we're going to start to see not only BLM in general, but Black people starting to request the removal of body cameras as more and more incidences where footage exonerates the cops and not the suspect surface. And I'll tack this last bit on too, in that despite of the public outpouring of sympathies for Justine and her family, Justine will be no Michael Brown. Oh, trust me, she's not going to be a cause that anyone's going to get behind long term. Perhaps if only she had had a slightly different skin tone and had just robbed a grocery store a few minutes earlier, she too could be a martyr and make national news for months. But given that Officer Noor was celebrated for his service in the Minneapolis police merely upon his induction for bravely, I guess, being Somali in origin, that's what it seems, and despite his three prior complaints from the community, two of which are still open and the third of which was dropped without any disciplinary action, I can say right now that I highly doubt there will be much marching in the streets in the name of Justine Ruschek. Yes, let's just say I doubt there will be demands to fry up a killer pig like Mohammed Noor like bacon in the streets, since that would be absolutely haram after all. Nor will this case spark calls from the typical Black Lives Matter activists and outlets for more training with the use of body camera technology. And maybe, you know what, maybe that was just because it's a Black migrant man who killed a white, also migrant woman, and that just doesn't fit in with the, oh, all cops hate Black people narrative. But moreover, I think it's because the entirety of BLM, fragmented as it is only when it's convenient for them to claim to be, I believe may in fact soon drop their support of that technology altogether. And, I'm not without point there. Interestingly enough, around the same time that this incident was gaining momentum on social media, far, far across the country in San Francisco, the Bay Area Rapid Transit announced that it would no longer be releasing video evidence of crimes committed and recorded on their CCTV because it would, quote, create a racial bias. See, I don't say this shit without evidence. Assistant General Manager of the BART, the BART system, said about the cessation of providing footage of crimes, claiming that the releasing of the footage induced a, quote, disproportionate elevation of crimes on transit interfaces with local media in such a way to unfairly affect and characterize riders of color, leading to sweeping generalizations in media reports and a high level of racially insensitive commentary. Did you get that, friends? Yep, facts are racist. So see, I'm not completely off base here then, am I? Black Lives Matter have proven themselves again and again to be a terrorist organization more concerned with causing violence while being bankrolled by people like George Soros than actually positively affecting Black communities. And all of this has certainly not positively affected relationship with the police forces they castigate as they shout in the streets slogans calling for the death of police officers. Yes, Black Lives Matter has no apparent intention to work peacefully with the police. While I may agree with the premise that the police should wear body cameras to help reduce corruption and inordinate violence that violates the rights and freedoms of citizens, I think soon, if these two incidences are any indication, we will find Black Lives Matter at large calling for the rescinding of body cameras, the self-same body cameras they so fought for. After all, if a black person did in fact do something and injures his or herself in a desperate attempt to escape, how can Samantha Weasley get money and pity points by milking her hospitalized baby daddy if there is in fact body cam footage that directly contradicts her claim of racially motivated violence? Well, there's no free gives in this scenario, so just like the Bart, we should probably just, you know, start removing these racist body cameras, am I right? I mean, tell me if I'm wrong, friends, but I'd put a few solid bucks that as more and more incidences of similar sort of types as this one come to public attention, more and more will we see Black Lives Matter call for the removal of body cams. Why? Because Black Lives Matter are just about the last fucking thing on the planet that matter to Black Lives Matter activists. No fucking lives matter to Black Lives Matter activists beyond their own. Why the fuck do you think they get so triggered by that all lives matter shit? A phrase that no one could ever possibly find unpalatable, so long as they give a flying fuck about the welfare of others. But they despise that hashtag, they despise that term, because they don't give a fuck about the lives of any person outside of themselves. These are selfish terrorists. That's because they don't just want attention. They don't just want sympathy. What they want is all of that, and all on top of it, on top of their little sundae, a great big helping of Gibbs. Well, no Gibbs for you or the We Slay family. Sorry about that, and sorry for your belief you could fly, that you could, you know, touch the sky, and that it was misplaced. I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. Think about it every night and day. Spread my wings and fly away. While I do feel a semblance of pity for this man who deeply injured himself, he is the only one responsible for his injuries. And as such, said pity that I feel, it's minimal. You did this to yourself. You're the one at fault. Take responsibility for your own actions. You and your baby mama are not going to get a fucking penny out of the Rainbow City Police for this. And thank Odin for the body cam footage that proved you jumped off that bridge yourself. But alas, this is a shorter video from me, and really only intended to serve as a sort of warning to never buy the shit you see posted on social media at face value, as well as a prediction that we will in fact soon see BLM screeching for the removal of body cam footage as it continues to reveal the reality of United States crime statistics, which indicate percentage-wise that blacks commit considerably more crime than whites in terms of percentage points, and insurmountably more crime than Asians. The problem with social justice warriors and Black Lives Matter and all kinds of ideological identity-based bullshit circle jerks is that they will continually take umbrage with facts and statistics that contradict their narrative. Sadly for them, though, reals are actually a bit more important than feels, at least as it comes to the criminal justice system. As such, facts cannot simply be denied when they are uncomfortable. Trust me, there are plenty of facts that I find distasteful, like, for example, that no matter how legal it is, I can never marry any of my anime husbandos. I mean, maybe legally, but no, not really. Does that make the facts any less factual? No! It's reality, asshole! Black Lives Matter. Them's just the breaks. Ratio-wise, check your shit. Black people commit far more crime, and in particular, far more homicide and far more robbery than white people. They are also, by that very same data, far more likely to be victimized. And they're far more likely to be victimized by other blacks, not by white people, not by the police, by other black people. So, you know what? Sit back and watch as whatever is left of Black Lives Matter starts to complain and cry and bitch about how racist the very sensical body camera equipment they themselves protested for will suddenly be called racist, as another example of whitey trying to keep the black man down. I mean, it certainly kept this dude down a whole 19 feet under a bridge that he threw himself off of to escape the police for merely asking him a question. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to like and subscribe. I'm Aiden Paladin, Ultana Volt.